to Griffith Park at 2333 Ferndale Place. The show begins at 10:30, but arrive at least 15 minutes before to check in. The shows are amusing and fun for the whole family. For ticket purchasing information and other details, go to laparks.org and click on Calendar of Events. And that's a look at some upcoming things to do. Community members came together in Pacoima recently to celebrate and honor African American Month through music, gospel music to be exact. Yana Kay reports.
Music fills the air at the Calvary Baptist Church of Pacoima. Local choirs are taking part in the festivities as local officials and community members celebrate the second annual Gospel Fest. Attendees say the event helps to inspire and bring hope to the community.
We know that as long as we keep our faith, as long as we continue to love one another, as long as we work together as a city, we'll make everything all right.
And by the looks of things, the event did bring everyone together as the audience stood up, sang, and clapped along with the music.
It's an opportunity for us to not only appreciate the music, but the importance that the music contributes to the community in terms of education and opening the eyes of young people in particular about how to use their talent in a very positive way.
The Gospel Fest also honors African American Heritage Month here in the city of Los Angeles. For the choir singers, the event brings out a lot of emotions.
You just feel the inspiration, and I just think about all the things I've been through and try to really pull it into the songs that we're singing and try to really feel the music.
I'm Yana Kay for LA This Week.
Funding for the Gospel Fest comes from the Los Angeles Department of Cultural Affairs. And that's going to do it for this edition. Thanks for joining us. I'm Ellen Chang. A reminder that you could catch us online at lacityview.org. You can also follow and like us on Facebook. We'll see you back here next week for more of LA This Week.
Managing your expenses can be challenging during difficult financial times. If you or your family has recently suffered a loss of income, you may now qualify for the Department of Water and Power's Residential Low Income Discount Program. The LADWP offers customers within qualifying income levels a subsidy on the cost of electric and water services for their primary residence. In addition, income-qualified senior citizens and disabled customers may be eligible for a discount lifeline rate. Customers on life support equipment and those who meet the physician's certified requirements may also apply for a discounted rate. To find out if you qualify for any of these discounts and to receive a low income discount application, please visit our website at www.ladwp.com.
You're watching
LA City View 35.
Our city,
our channel.
We're LA girls who are watching TV now. LA City View 35.
Test 1, 2, 3. Test 1, 2.
Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome to this special meeting of the Budget and Finance Committee for Monday, March 18th, 2013. I'm Paul Krikorian, Chair of the Committee. I'm joined by the Honorable Bill Rosendahl. And the purpose for today's special meeting, held in, at this unusual time, is to make it easier for the public both to participate in this process by hearing the reports about where we stand with the city's budget, what's anticipated for the coming fiscal year, and also to provide input into that process. So that's why we set up this special evening hearing. In the past, as many of you know, there's been a budget on the road process by which special meetings were held at various locations around the city. And frankly, that experience did not generate the degree of public involvement that we would have hoped, and it was considerably more expensive than having a meeting here. So what we have done tonight is made the council chambers available to the public, but also made the council chambers in Van Nuys and San Pedro available for people to provide input. We also have connecting with people live through Twitter, so people can participate on Twitter under the handle at CD2News. And then we're also live streaming this on the website at councilcommittee.lacity.org/budget. And through that website, members of the public, wherever they may be, can provide questions, can provide comments on the budget. And if they come in during the course of tonight's hearing, we'll try to get to as many as we can and actually present some of those questions to the staff before we conclude tonight. But in any event, whether it happens tonight or as we continue over the next few weeks and months of hearing the coming budget, we're very much eager to hear the comments and suggestions of the public with regard to budget solutions to the challenges that are facing us. And I should say that there has been considerable progress already made over the last 4 years in addressing the budget challenges that the city has faced. Just a few years ago, the next fiscal year was projected to have a $1 billion budget deficit for 2013-2014. Now, over 80% of that projected deficit has already been eliminated through a combination of efficiencies, position eliminations, increased employee contributions to their health and welfare packages, pension reform, as well as increased fees and other sorts of revenues like that. So there has been progress made, but there is still considerable work to be done. And as I think we'll hear tonight when the CAO presents his overview, there still is a substantial looming budget deficit for the coming fiscal year, but more importantly, there remains a structural deficit that needs to be addressed over the course of a number of years. So our purpose tonight is to present as much information as we can to the public and to receive as much information as we can from those that we represent about how best to wrestle with these challenges. So we're going to start this evening with a presentation by our CAO, Miguel Santana, and also our CLA, Jerry Miller, who I'd like to ask to come up to the table now. And following their presentation, we'll also be hearing a formal presentation by the Neighborhood Council Budget Advocates, who will present particularly with regard to cash flow issues. And then we'll be hearing from the public who are here in the chambers and also those who are submitting questions through the internet as well. So if you would like to offer comment, if you're here in the chambers and would like to offer comment, please fill out one of these white cards and bring it forward, and we will get to those comments at the conclusion of the presentations. So now I'd like to turn the microphone over to my colleagues who may want to offer some introductory comments. Mr. Rosendahl.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. I welcome the budget advocates. I welcome the neighborhood councils. It's all about our city, and we are our city, you and I, and it's for us to do what we think is the best and the right thing to do. I've been on this committee for 8 years. I've seen a dynamic from one to another, to this, to that, to the other. And frankly, this will be my last time on the council until I leave, which will be the end of June. And I am a firm believer that basic services are key for our taxpayers. And I might also say that I listen to my 8 neighborhood councils a lot, and I learn a lot, and we learn a lot from each other. So I want to thank all of you who have come down here and are sitting in Van Nuys or sitting in San Pedro to come on and let's make this work. Let's put the best budget together that we can conceivably make, because we are a team effort, you and us together. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you very much, Mr. Rosendahl. And we're joined also by Councilmember Paul Kretz. Mr. Kretz, would you like to offer any thoughts at the outset?
Yeah, I mean, we've been doing this for a few years in this crisis mode, and I think we've done a pretty good job, actually, in making cuts and implementing efficiencies, doing a lot of things that we didn't want to do, but we didn't have a choice because we came up so short in terms of revenue. We still have a shortfall. I think some people want to understate it, and it may be true that it's a little less for this year, but structurally, we still have a big hole to fill. And the following year, we expect to still be a very substantial shortfall. We don't know how much worse it'll be made by the federal government, and I hope we have some a good process to take that into account and don't leave ourselves short in this process. But I particularly appreciate the input that we've been getting for these 4 years. And we've gotten a lot of good ideas, and some of them have gotten implemented for efficiencies. And one of the things I've tried to do is make sure we capture those and consider them seriously. I think various people's ideas have saved us tens of millions of dollars in this process already. So I for one, will be keeping my ears open for those opportunities. I think this year, we have to capture some of the efficiencies that we've talked about for several years but not implemented, and that I think should be our push to help close that gap for the year.
Very good. Thank you very much, colleagues. And Mr. Santana, welcome.
Thank you. Miguel Santana, CAO. I'll give an overview of a presentation as to where we're at. Much of this you already heard, but I think it's important for the public to get a sort of overview on the city's overall finances. So we do have good news, and we also have some challenging news. The good news is that the budget today is balanced for this fiscal year, and we actually have a reserve fund that meets and actually exceeds your policy of 5% of the general fund. We're seeing revenue trends improve due to the improvement in the economy and major revenue from property tax, sales tax, hotel occupancy taxes, and others are increasing, and we expect them to be anywhere between 2.5 to 2.7%. You've achieved major milestones on pension reform, and as a result, we're starting to see bear fruit from that difficult work that's been laid out over the last few years. 80% of the structural deficit, as you talked about, Mr. Chairman, has been solved. Once projected to be over $1 billion, is now hovering around $200 million starting July 1st of this year. We have already solutions for part of that problem, $45 million from pension savings and about $50 million of new revenue that we expect to receive. These two pieces alone are part of the ongoing solutions that help reduce the structural deficits in the future. And you have taken appropriate action by establishing a budget stabilization fund for the first time that started the fiscal year at, what, $500,000 and will end at about $70 to $80 million, an unprecedented amount of work that you've done to be able to prepare us for the future of next year. The challenging news is, of course, we're still facing a deficit next year, and as Mr. Koretz indicated, we will face it in the future. We have major liabilities floating out there. The Ardon case, which challenges our utility users tax, our case against our sidewalks, and we have a growing police banked overtime that needs to start to be addressed. We've cut the city down to the bone, over 5,300 positions, eliminated to 2007-8, the smallest government since Tom Bradley was mayor. And our cost drivers continue to grow between 4.5% to 5%, and those include pension, health care, workers' comp, and employee compensation, which is still higher than the rate of our revenues. Even with pension reform, the contribution for next year is still expected to be 12.5% higher than it was this fiscal year. And our attempt to bring in new revenue to the city was met by a no from the voters of Los Angeles. So that as a solution, unfortunately, is not before you today. And as we indicated, our four-year outlook continues to show ongoing deficits in light of the fact that our revenues are growing at about 2.7%, but yet our expenditures are growing at almost 4%. So as you indicated, Mr. Chairman, you have done significant work in reducing the structural deficit. The most significant part of that solution has included pension savings. Some of the work was done by the pension systems. A lot of it was done in partnership with labor, having most city employees start contributing towards retiree health care. And then, of course, the reform with the new pension tier for our sworn personnel and the new tier that will be in place on July 1st. Another significant portion has been departmental cuts throughout the city. And then, of course, the revenue growth. 177 of new revenue since we tracked the deficit. And some of that comes to the fact that when there was the dissolution of the CRA, the city chose to fold those new revenues into the general fund. On pensions, this next chart really illustrates how significant the reform has been. Back in 2010, we projected that our pension contribution for July 1st of 2013 would be $1.2 billion, a 15% increase on average. It is now growing at 11%, significantly less. And so what we know now to be our pension contribution for next year will be $954 million, even less than what we projected not that long ago. So while our pension costs still continue to grow, they're not growing at the same rate as projected. And we received the illustrations from the two pension system for the outgoing years, and we're seeing the same growth occur, again, not at the same pace as previously projected. The next chart you've seen many times, it shows how our staffing levels has been reduced by over 14%, the most significant portion being, of course, in the non-sworn police, in particular departments, both sworn and civilian in the police department. So that means in our efforts to try to protect public safety, we've had to reduce the rest of the city disproportionately. The next chart shows you the real good news in terms of finally reaching a reserve fund that meets your goal and a growing budget stabilization fund, which is part of the health of the financial future for the city. Hopefully in the next few weeks, we will be issuing, in partnership with the CLA, a report to this committee on how to make ensure that we have a vibrant budget stabilization fund in the future that allows us to budget away any revenues that are beyond the trend line. The next slide shows how difficult the task is in front of you. Out of the $7.2 billion budget for next year, 48% is restricted. You know, people always ask, well, why is it that you can't find $216 million out of a $7.2 billion budget? Well, when you look at what's restricted, meaning these dollars have to go for a very specific purpose. Almost half of the budget is that you have no discretion over. And then 47% goes to those things that are critical to the city: police, fire, library, rec and parks, public works, transportation, building safety, convention center, and planning. And then it's only 5%, 359, that funds everything else: animal services, city attorney, controller, my office, the cultural affairs, emergency management, finance, the mayor, your offices, city clerk, disability, Dunn, zoo, and a handful of other departments. So you would think that with a budget our size, we would be able to find solutions, but given our limitations, it becomes very, very daunting. This gives you an illustration of how challenging it is to adopt further cuts in light of the cuts that have been approved so far. So in 2006-07, the zoo received a contribution of $10.6 million. That's been reduced down to $1.3 million. The staffing levels from 263 to down to 218. Animal services has seen over 20% reduction in their staffing levels, yet obviously the demand remains the same. But the most devastating is obviously in ITA and GSD. In 2008-09, GSD had 1,916 employees. In this fiscal year, they're down to 1,262. And in ITA, they went from 807 down to 479, a very dramatic reduction in our staffing, 34% in GSD reduction and 41% in ITA. While we had a conversation this afternoon about how the deficit is established, and part of it is obviously we look at revenues, but we also look at what's happening on the expenditure side. And based on the budgets that have been submitted both by the Police Commission and the Fire Commission, we know that in order to maintain service levels in those two departments, they're requesting an additional $130 million. $41 million just to take care of COLAs that have been committed to the sworn personnel, another seven for civilians. $35 million in a number of expenses due to the cost of living that's in various programs that they have, and then another $47 for vehicles and other equipment that need to be replaced. Chart 10 tells a story as to why it was important to place a new revenue source to the city. So you've all seen this chart before that shows the deficits in the future. The bottom blue line represents the revenue. The red line represents the expenditures. The middle line shows what it would have looked like if Measure A had passed. And we all know that it hasn't passed. So we would have gone from revenue growth of 2.5%, which we have now, to revenue growth of 3.6%. That obviously is not what we have now, and so now we have to find ways to reduce the expenditure line through a number of cuts. Our ability to increase revenue are obviously much more difficult. We issued a report that your committee considered yesterday, urging you that as you move forward in resolving the budget for next year, that you keep in mind the importance of adopting ongoing solutions, not just one-time solutions. There's a great temptation to just look at our budget year after year after year, and for the last 4 years we've had to do that due to the crisis. Now that we know that new revenue is not an option, we would recommend that we move forward on a strategy to try to eliminate the structural deficit over the next 3 years, in part by taking on each deficit with 70% ongoing solutions and only 30% one-time solutions. As we get one-time dollars, in addition to helping plug in our deficit, and we would recommend only limit it to a third, we also think it's time that we start investing in our infrastructure, in our streets and sidewalks, in buying equipment for various departments, in our information technology, in our buildings. Over the last 4 years, we have not been in a position to invest in those needs to the extent necessary, as well as to maintain a healthy budget stabilization fund so that we could be prepared for some of these looming liabilities. And so that means for every dollar that you use that's one time for a one-time problem, you have to find ongoing solutions, and none of them will be easy. And today, you directed us to move forward and identify a number of savings that could be done, both to reduce our labor costs, which are the most significant part of our budget, but also to identify further reductions and department consolidations and efficiencies that will be considered as part of the budget process. So with that, I'll be happy to answer any questions following Mr. Miller's comments.
Thank you. Mr. Miller.
Good evening. I'll be very brief. For purposes of the public, in terms of the council budget process, my office works with this committee and all of your colleagues, once the mayor's budget comes out, to provide you with an analysis of what the budget contains, the one-time versus ongoing solutions, any issues and concerns that we see, and then work with all of you to try and have all of your priorities funded. Now, it's also important to know that I know in a variety of situations, Miguel and I addressed neighborhood councils a couple of weeks ago on the economic development issue, and a common theme is time for neighborhood councils to be able to review and respond to issues. So I think it's important for the public to understand that the process that governs the budget is really dictated by the city charter. Under the city charter, the mayor has to release the budget by April 20th. This year, that falls on a Saturday, and our expectation is it would be great to have it on the 9th. We could use the weekend, but our assumption is that it's going to come out on the 22nd. So we're working with the chair's office in putting the schedule together. But you all have to pass a budget by June 1st, which is on the weekend. So basically, we're looking at Memorial Day by March 31st. The council must pass the budget, or May 31st. The council must pass the budget, or the mayor's budget goes into effect. So the schedule tentatively would be the budget comes out on the 22nd. You start your hearings on April 30th. Those hearings go through May 8th, and you hear all through all of the departments and get responses from the public, et cetera. We then need to work to write the report based on the hearings, and we bring it back to you on around the 14th of May. Then we need to write the final report and bring it back on the 15th or the 16th. Then you're going to present the budget to the council on May 17th. On Monday, May 20th, is the tentative hearing date for the entire budget to be discussed in front of the full council. We need a few days to then actually write the budget resolution, which gets us to the 24th. And then we have to come back to the council with the actual budget resolution that gets passed to the mayor. And that's scheduled at this point to be around the 29th. So you have about 2 days to play with. So I do understand that it's frustrating, but these schedules, again, are dictated by the charter, and there is no flexibility in meeting those. So, again, we'll be working with all of your offices throughout this process, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Very good. Thank you. Colleagues, questions?
No. We did it in committee, by the way, this morning. I really want to hear from the public and your attitudes on this. Thanks.
Okay. Mr. Kretz?
I'll join Mr. Rosendahl on that. We already discussed it to some degree, so I think we're more here to listen.
Well, let me just offer a few questions up that we frequently hear, because I think this will be an opportunity for you to explain some things that we hear a lot from the public. The reserve fund, you talked about the fact that we now have a reserve fund that is in excess of 5%, meeting the city's financial policies. This is the highest the reserve fund has been in about a decade, as I understand it. Mm-hmm. Why does that matter? Why can't we simply dip into that reserve fund to help pay for some of these deficits? Well, we actually did do that a few years ago. A few years ago, if you recall, in the height of our fiscal crisis, the city had to rely on the reserve fund to end the year in the black. And one of the reasons we were downgraded not just once but twice was because we had to do that.
And downgraded by credit rating agencies.
That's
and
correct.
What's the result of such a downgrade?
So our credit rating is sort of the equivalent of a FICO score when you buy a car or you buy a house, and it plays a major role in determining how investors look at our credit and ultimately determines how attractive of a city we are in terms of the purchasing of bonds. And the city borrows, you know, billions of dollars on a regular basis, in good times and in bad times. We do it at the beginning of the year to pay off our pension obligations and for cash flow reasons. Doing that allows us about a $30 million discount, not insignificant, to pay our pension obligation in the middle of July. We do that because we borrow TRAN every year. We borrow for capital needs and a variety of different responsibilities that we have. And our reserve fund is necessary. The other reason it's necessary is that, you know, most people don't realize, but the city is self-insured. You know, the next major earthquake or natural disaster, we have to rely on ourselves first before we can expect any assistance from FEMA and the federal government. And so that there's a portion of the reserve fund that's dedicated for that purpose. But it has to be maintained. So it's no minor task. I mean, that in the worst of times, your council has been committed to building the reserve fund in a responsible way. We didn't do it overnight. It was last year we had a very extensive conversation about that priority, and we've been able to do it. And so it's now that we hit that, it's equally as important to move forward on a budget stabilization fund so that when we're short or when we have a liability that comes, we don't rely on the reserve fund to meet it, that we actually have another fund to go from in light of those challenges.
Now, a number of, we frequently hear from some in the public that the city has lots of outstanding debt that it should be collecting, that there's hundreds of millions of dollars out there that should be collected, in part due to the work of the neighborhood councils. Working with the city council, we have now put in place an inspector general for collections. And can you talk a little bit about why we can't solve the budget deficit by simply collecting debt that's owed to the city?
Well, it's a, you know, I think the inspector general has done a great job in sort of demystifying the issue of debt by making it clear where it really comes from. The bulk of it comes from our ambulance collection, and the reason why that exists is because the indigent don't pay whenever they get transported, either, and they don't have insurance, so there's no insurance to go after. They're homeless, or they're just not financially capable to pay. If you have insurance, the city's actually very aggressive and has moved forward in being more aggressive by privatizing that function and using more effective technology to capture the identification and the insurance of the individuals at the time that they get picked up. Another big piece is, of course, parking, and the city does do better than most on parking collection. We're above the average. Certainly, there's always room for improvement, but it's an area where it's going to be harder to capture. I think the report that was issued by the Inspector General gives us some challenges, and he lays out strategies to use more effective technology, to look at partnering with the private sector, to improve our own internal processing of some of these collections. But at the end of the day, the bottom line conclusion is that it's not the panacea to all of our problems. It is a piece of the solution. It's not the entire solution.
Now, some would say, well, why don't you just cut pay for public employees? Why don't you just change pension benefits for current retirees? Why is that not a solution for our budget deficit?
Well, to the extent permissible, this council has in fact done some of that. City employees up until recently used to receive retiree health care for free for themselves and their partner or spouse. And in working with labor, most city employees now pay for that benefit. And it was not an insignificant thing for them to do. It's something that people pay for as a way of ensuring that that benefit exists, and it's a big part of the solution on pensions. But the law is fairly clear as to what we could do with current employees on their pension systems. It's a vested right. The day that someone signs up as a city employee, the pension plan that is given to them is one that they're entitled to receive on the day they retire. And so until that law is changed, then our ability to change that system is rather limited. But that is not the case for new employees. And your council has adopted very assertive pension reform for new employees, both on the civilian and the sworn side.
So under state and federal law, any pension reform regarding retirees who have vested pension rights, this is a part of their compensation package that they have earned through a lifetime of work.
That's right.
And under state and federal law, that can't be taken away, even through collective bargaining, unless there's comparable value that's offered in return for that reduction in pension costs.
That is correct. So even if we were to take it to reach an agreement with labor, the members were to vote for it and agree to pay significantly more to their pensions, an individual can still challenge that, right?
Okay.
Because they would argue that they need the like benefit in return. Of course, that law is being challenged by initiatives in San Diego and San Jose. It'll be years before that gets resolved.
And then just to put a kind of a context into those who would suggest, well, there's a lot more that the city should be cutting. There's departments that we don't even need in the city. The city should function on it should concentrate on its core services and so forth. What percentage of the general fund is currently expended now on the police department, and what percentage of the general fund is currently expended on the fire department?
Well, combined public safety represents 72% of the discretionary dollars that your council has. So, public safety consistently gets identified as the number one priority, and in fact, that's what you have done. You have funded public safety. Even in these very difficult times, the police force has been consistently maintained at 10,000 officers. The results of that are clear in the community, and it's been a challenge to maintain fire at the levels. But even under these difficult times, while they experienced 1 year of drop in revenue last year, you provided a significant increase in revenue to make up for some of that. We continue to support efforts to hire firefighters because if we don't hire firefighters, we end up paying it in overtime. And so we've now hit that point where new firefighters are necessary to contain our overtime costs. And, we went out and opened an exam, and we got over 13,000 applications for 140 slots. So it's probably easier to get into Harvard than to become a firefighter for the city of Los Angeles. But it's something that the city needs to start doing, even in these difficult times, because we end up paying for it in a different way.
And of the 28% of the budget that, of the discretionary portion of the budget that's not spent on police and fire, that 28% includes the city attorney's office, emergency management, some of public works, transportation, street services, building and safety, and a number of other expenditures that I think most people would associate as being at least indirectly related to the safety of the public.
That's
Is that right?
Including, rec and parks, recreational services, the gang prevention program, So there's public safety we're defining with that 72% with police and fire, but obviously it's a much larger array of services, not just those two.
All right. Thank you very much. So I'd like to go now to the Neighborhood Council budget advocates, and I think Dr. Weissman is here to present on behalf of the budget advocates. So Dr. Weissman, if you could come on forward, please. All right, Dr. Weissman, I understand you have about a 10-minute presentation primarily dealing with cash flow issues, so welcome.
Thank you very much. I want to start by introducing the people who bring this to. Would you budget advocates please stand? Several of them have gone upstairs because it's coincidental our meeting is going on at the same time upstairs. Any of you who put in public comment should know that if you wish
face
to
the microphone, please. Face
on
the microphone.
This, then you should change your card to a public comment on the issues that Mr. Santana, Mr. Miller, and I are talking about here. By the way, if anybody sees my working copy of my document, I'd appreciate it. Mr. Santana told me that his group was up until late hours last night preparing the material for you. So have I, except he's got better access to the IT, so this document is available for anyone, and it has much of the comment that we've put together for your benefits.
And how do they get access to that if they're watching this on TV?
I don't know if your camera can zoom in on it. I'll try to show a couple of the documents. Contact me, contact the budget advocates. It's been sent out rather widely, and it isn't posted on any specific place. We were hoping to have a place on the LACity.org that would take some of our documents, but we budget advocates are meeting very regularly. We're about to meet with the mayor, and through the courtesy of the chairman of the Budget and Finance Committee, we'll be making a much more detailed formal presentation before the City Council. I hope my colleagues took down all of those dates that Mr. Miller mentioned, because we're going to try to be there with you and as many of them as we can.
Thank you very much. And thank you to all of you who are here for the extraordinary work that you're doing. This is exceptionally time-consuming, and I just want to thank all the budget advocates for the entirely volunteer effort that you put in to helping the city manage its way through this budget situation. So, Dr. Weissman, please.
As a form of introduction, if anyone in the viewing audience doesn't know, we Neighborhood Council budget advocates are elected by our colleagues that are called budget representatives from each of the 95 neighborhood councils. We're here to represent the entire city. I should have asked the stakeholders to get up when the budget advocates got up, because then all of us should have gotten up. We are supposed to represent not only all the citizens of this city, but all the people who have a legitimate concern and activity here. So our constituency is far greater than really the constituency of a city councilman, with all respect to you and your work. Now, I'd like to make one quick comment about Measure A. It was rejected 53 or so to 47. That's not the end of the world. That's not the only issue. That's not the reason we're having a budget crunch right now. There is so much more in this $7.2 or $3 billion budget that can be considered and accounted for. We have a situation now, though, when many of those one-time ideas that Mr. Santana spoke about have already been used, and he wants to use some of the new money, and there is some new money coming in, to take care of certain kinds of one-time issues. It doesn't solve the structural deficit problem, but it can help some too. But with that context, everything should be on the table. I think this time, as much as any time in the last several years, since everything is on the table, no matter where the recommendations come from, that you city council members, the mayor, you are decision makers on our budget, should give us as good an ear as you possibly can consider what we're suggesting and be sure we thoroughly vet it. We've tried to be thorough in our evaluation and try to meet as many of the oppositions of the pros and cons of the various issues we're bringing to you. I want to say at the start of this that the budget proposal is a guess. It's a dream. It's a proposal. It's a plan. It isn't reality. It's something you're going to try to do. You do this each year. We do this. We're all part of the same city. And then from that point forward, you try to make it into a reality. Now, we have a structural deficit, which will be announced in the mayor's budget within the next month. And that structural deficit number will stay the same all year long, even though changes in income, expense, unexpected events in both directions may alter the amount that we really have to clear so that we can end up in a zero balance at the end of the year. The city does a very fine job of that, and it's guided very expertly by our CAO. But we have to, I think at this time, and there is a real move to change our attitude toward budgeting. This city is basically an item-based budget because 85% or more of all of our general fund is dedicated to salaries, to benefits, and to pension benefits. That is the driving force for this structural deficit. We have a group of employees, a fine group actually, that's been clipped. And we're paying more for them to do, who of course can only do less, and all of us suffer for that. We all suffer in terms of the services we're receiving. Our job as neighborhood council people is to advise the council and mayor on the services we're receiving, and indeed this is what we're doing right now. The problem is that we now have an item-based budgeting system where we don't budget for tasks, for performances, for services. We budget for the number of people we can afford. But recently there's been a move to do performance-based budgeting in order to fill in a gap. You spoke of it earlier today, Mr. Englander spoke of it earlier today, about finding out what is it that the city really produces, finding out what do we really need to produce. What do we need to maintain in our infrastructure? What do we need to plan for in the numbers of police vehicles we need to have? All of these things are not in our budget process right now. And if I could recommend one thing, it would be to find out what we're doing, workload and analyze, cost-benefit analysis, our budget, so we can at least tell the public, what do we think we should be doing? What are we doing? How can we close that gap? And how much money does it cost to do it? At that point, maybe things like Measure A failure won't happen. The public will know what they're buying. Mr. Englander put out a very excellent performance-based budgeting process, which included an analysis of personnel and administration, number two, technology considerations, number three, customer service and satisfaction, documentation, number four, the financial management, that's cost basis. And then the city services provided, and that's what we spoke about just a moment ago. Now, as I said, the budget is a guess, it's a dream. That doesn't mean it's facetious in any way. But we find out what really happened when we look at the cash flow of the city. The cash flow of the city is produced by, and in the past has been reported on, by the city controller office. We had a gentleman by the name of Bill Lamb. I hope most of you remember that name. It would be the person who would ordinarily be coming before you, and I hope there'll be others who come before you to speak about the cash flow. Most of my colleagues know that I'm going to show this document. This is an analysis of cash flow, and it's in the documents here, and they're available to everyone in the room and to everyone else. This is an analysis of the cash flow of our city. The controller pays our bills, all of them, and so the controller's office knows where the money's going. It also gets the information from the Office of Finance and from the CAO to know what incomes we have. But our city goes in the red every month from July 1st when we start our budget until December and January when the property taxes come in and are paid. Now, until then, we have to borrow on the TRAN, which you heard Mr. Santana said. The TRAN is now a $1.256 billion debt that we have this year. Two-thirds of it goes to make an early payment to our pension plans, both of them, and about $450 million every year is used. So we'll have enough cash to pay that first 6 months' worth of obligations. The big piece of it, of course, is salaries. Every 2 weeks, the controller writes checks for about, originally it was $105 million earlier this year, now it's more like $110 to $112 million. Every 2 months, healthcare and dental plan adds another $31 million every other month. Like many of us who pay Blue Cross, you pay every second month. And then some of it has to be set aside to be able to fund our pension plan. All of that money is reality in the cash flow document, and it's well worth talking about and well worth learning about. Now, there are two measures that we brought to you every year for the last several years. This is, I hope, the year you'll do it, and I hope the timing is adequate to be able to do the first one as soon as possible. That is the shift of the payment of the power transfer, which usually comes into the city starting in February or March and then is completed by the end of May most of the years. That's money that accrues during the current year and then is due on the July 1st. The Department of Water and Power knows pretty well how much they've made, and the payment that they're supposed to pay during the year can be calculated at least roughly on that. If we move that money up to July 1st, it should be something in the order of $240 to $250 million that would then help us to get through that first 6 months that we don't have. If we did that, that would decrease the line of credit part of the TRAN to about $200 million. The other item, and this is very hot and very complex, perhaps we'll have another time to speak of it. I see
you
my
will.
Time is running. Thank you. I can't tell you how much I appreciate that two words. Thank you. Is the payments of our business tax. You've had just recently some very important information about it in which the proposal is to phase out business taxes over a 15-year period of time. I'm going to propose that we use that 15 years to move the business taxes from February, when they're usually paid, to July 1st. That means that all the businesses, at the same time they're doing their federal and state income taxes, can be calculating their business taxes. You can then receive those in July. There'll be a lag of 1 year for each of these 15 groups that may be implemented over a 15-year period of time. That's $450 million. I think we have to look at that because I don't see the TRAN diminishing yet, and I do see the expenses of the city continuing for the next several years. So hopefully in a 15-year period of time, we can have enough money to do our business every year. And by the way, if we can eliminate that $450 million of TRAN or bring it down to, say, $50 to $100 million, well, a line of credit's reasonable, we can eliminate something between $5 and $10 million. The last issue, and then I'll ask for questions or whatever you wish, is the fact that that TRAN costs this city $5 to $10 million. We've just saved you enough money to restore all the money that we neighborhood council people have been asking be returned, because we're getting to the tipping point right now. What if we could save you $5 to $10 million or more with the recommendations we're making? Would you restore our money? Would you bring us back to having elections every 2 years as the charter wants us? Would you refund or fund adequately the Department of Neighborhood Empowerment, on which we are dependent for many specific services. And then there are two issues here. When you get this close to being unable to perform your services, there are legal issues. The Neighborhood Council's budget was to have been set every 2 years, that so-called Section 911, and that section indicates that year-to-year kind of changes, such as we're suffering this year, may not be legal and may put the city in certain kinds of jeopardy. Again, my very grateful thanks as a person representing the people here from the Budget Advocates, from the Neighborhood Councils. We greatly appreciate this offer. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Weissman. And I just, again, want to thank you and all the Budget Advocates for your work. And I also want to reiterate that this is not the only opportunity for the Budget Advocates to be heard. We will be, as we have in past years, asking you to come and do a presentation to the Budget and Finance Committee on all of your work. That will be at a date soon to be set, and then we'll hopefully be able to have you before the council as well. So this was not the only opportunity to provide input. So thank you very much, colleagues. Mr. Rosendahl?
No, I just want to thank you. You spoke before our committee today. You did a great job, and you've done a great job over the last 3 or 4 years. Historically, I was here when we first brought you in as part of the family. It was a no-brainer for me, as it is with the unions. It's a no-brainer for me. We're all family here, and if we can work together, we obviously can make the city a better place. So, and nobody has the monopoly on the information and the knowledge. This is a work in progress that is constantly a work in progress. I have to leave here shortly because I have to be in Brentwood at the Brentwood Homeowners Association, and I'm speaking before that group. But I wanted to at least symbolically let you know that every time you speak, I listen. And every time the community gets engaged on these issues, I listen, and I know many other elected officials do, who believe that together we're making it work. The fact that you put all this time and energy in and don't get paid a cent, you know, tells us a lot about who you are and what you really care about. And the group in the room here who take a deep interest in all of the aspects of this great city. So I applaud you for who you are, and I look forward over the next, for me, 100 days to work with you closely.
Thank you, Mr. Rosendahl. And by the way, it's indicative of the work done overall throughout the Neighborhood Council movement, that there is so much activism and dynamism and volunteer service performed by our Neighborhood Council board members and committee members throughout the city. I don't know where the city would be able to make up for that work if we didn't have the Neighborhood Council activists performing those volunteer services. And Mr. Rosendahl, I know your day is not nearly done yet.
No.
It's 10 after 7, and you're still continuing on with your work day. Thank you very much for making the time to be able to be here in your busy schedule. Mr. Kretz.
Yeah, I'll just echo Mr. Rosendahl's comments because he said it better than I could. But I do have one question for the CAO. We've heard this suggested before on the ways to save money based on the cash flow suggestions that were made, and I've never entirely understood why we thought that wasn't practical. Is there any way to give that more serious consideration, see if we indeed can save a few million dollars by the timing of our cash flow?
Well, we're somewhat like a business. You know, when you plan out a year, not all of our revenue comes in on the same day. We don't get, you know, over $7 billion on July 1st. It comes in throughout the year. And the property taxes and sale taxes and all of our revenue streams are on a particular schedule, which Mr. Weissman is correct. During the first quarter of the year, we're actually, if we had to rely exclusively on those revenues, we wouldn't have enough to make payroll. In order to change that schedule, we would have to require, for example, on the business tax, that all of the businesses pay up front. And I think that would be certainly a controversial move to do. The trend is actually something that works well for the city, particularly now. Keep in mind that for this fiscal year, we borrowed over $1 billion at about 28 basis points, a fairly tiny amount. The cost of how much we borrowed was the equivalent of about 3.5 million dollars. We save $30 million by paying our pension obligation on July 15th. And so we immediately save more money by issuing the TRAN than what we even had to pay in interest. So it's, at least for now, it certainly makes sense in light of the low interest rate and the schedule that we are on revenue.
Well, if I may on that, Mr. Santana, that we save the money by making the prepayment.
That's right.
So whether it's generated from a TRAN or another source, that it's the prepayment that's saving the money. So, for example, would it make sense or is it feasible to move up the date of receipt or recommend to the DWP moving up the date of the receipt of the power revenue transfer would be one suggestion that Dr. Wiseman has suggested. And then on the business tax, I wasn't exactly clear on, you said that we would have to require prepayment. Couldn't we, instead of requiring prepayment, simply change the fiscal year upon which businesses are paying their taxes so that the tax payment comes due earlier in the year without requiring prepayment, but just changing the calendar so that those due dates are earlier in the year? Is that not
feasible? I mean, we could certainly look into both of those requests. I know that maybe, Jerry, you could speak to.
Yeah, I think the biggest issue with the water and power transfer is that they can't make the transfer until they close the books for the prior fiscal year.
That's right.
So they couldn't make it in June and July. They have to go through their audit and they have to close the books.
So they would need to change their entire accounting system, their entire fiscal year in order to...
Correct. They'd have to change essentially their fiscal year from January January through December. They'd have to move it by 6 months in order to move the payment up 6 months. Mm-hmm. And in terms of the costs, years ago, very brief, a little bit of history, we first started doing trans only to make the pension payment. During the Reardon administration, there was a big push to issue pension bonds to pay off our pension liability. Keith Comrie was the CAO at the time, and I was in the debt group at the time, and we strongly recommended against that. But what we did identify is the ability to prepay and pay a very, very low interest rate on the trans, and by assuming that we get the 8% interest by prepaying the pension system, it was a substantial savings. Internal borrowing also has a cost to it. We can't borrow from special funds without reimbursing them many times with interest, which is also higher. So again, moving the business tax is an important issue, and I couldn't agree with Dr. Wiseman more. We need to look at ways of reducing the trans, but there are some, you know, very good reasons why we do some of the stuff in the trans.
Sure.
Of the business tax, I think that one of the challenges is that while we're on a fiscal schedule, most businesses are on the calendar based on their federal income tax. And so the planning for that may create a disruption from some of those businesses. Can I think it's not an impossible thing to change, but it certainly will require some deliberation and some outreach with the business community.
And consideration of whether there might be adverse impacts on our continuing efforts to try to attract more business.
That's right.
To come to Los Angeles. Okay. Mr. Kretz, would that...
That was my only question.
Very good. Thank you. So we'll go now to some of our public comment cards, and we'll take 2 minutes per speaker, and if you haven't already filled out a card and would like to speak, they're available here in the room. Just bring them on forward. Our first speaker will be Deep Patel, followed by Jeffrey Stansfield.
Good evening, Council. Mr. Santana.
Good evening. Welcome.
Hi. My name is Deep Patel, and I'm the founder of Gigawatt. And several years ago, I started working with the Bureau of Street Lighting on an innovative project called Solar to Grid. And it was a pilot project where they put up solar panels on the side of street light poles and put the power back into DWP's system. And over the several years that we've been in this pilot project, they started to understand how the system worked and the power it put in. And through that process, they started to talk about how can we deploy this on a larger scale. And Mr. Santana, we had a meeting with some people in your offices regarding a financial mechanism we can use to allow the city to deploy these units without any upfront investment from the city and actually earn a positive income from selling the power back to DWP. So it'd be an internal power purchasing agreement between the city and DWP. And we have financial backers that are banks that are have an intent to finance a project like this. So what we're offering is a way for the city to basically make income. It's one of the ongoing solutions you're looking for. And the possible income stream based on the scale of the project could be anywhere from $700,000 to $7 million over a 25-year period. In addition to the electrical side, in terms of the power sales, I drive around sometimes and I see the street lights are on during the day or they're off at night. And our systems can pick up on that and send an alert out to the field workers to solve those problems quickly, thus saving the city even more money. And finally, we have to work with DWP. That's the biggest challenge to getting this all going, and it's being considered right now. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you very much, Mr. Patel. Our next speaker is Jeffrey Stansfield, followed by Jonathan Reich.
Welcome. Like you, the neighborhood council members have a deep love for the city. I know you and the council members are only trying to do your best to help the city, and I applaud what you do. I wanted to point out some things. You know, there's a $3.5 billion. If you were to hire all the neighborhood council people who worked for the neighborhood councils, it would cost you in excess of $3.5 billion to hire us for the time we put, just paying us minimum wage. The Inspector General has given you about 65 recommendations that the budget advocates have put forward. I'm asking you not to rock the boat on making a decision that that the upcoming mayor candidates, many councilmen, including Mr. Zine, who signed a petition against moving our budget down. In fact, he signed it, making our budget back to $50,000. Also, on the moving our elections, you know, I was talking to Mr. Titanich, your city attorney, and as far as he's concerned, it's actually would be an illegal action to move our elections. So I would ask you to, before you do that, to please have some more meetings with him, because he told us that in a meeting the other day. The basic, you know, as Mr. Rosenthal and Mr. Kikorian, you said that the neighborhood councils provide basic services. We provide basic services. We are your connection to the people of the city. We fund things like MEND and the Boys and Girls Club and the National Night Out, which brings together the police department and the residents. We provide these basic services. And like you said, where would we be without the neighborhood council? And we are here. Please support us. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.
By the way, I have a draft of a petition that it hasn't been approved. It's going to be approved on Wednesday. I have three copies for you guys, and I have 50 copies for anybody else who wants it.
Thank you very much. Our next speaker is Jonathan Reich, followed by I think it's Pam Custeo, but I'm not sure. If I mangled that, I'm sorry. Mr. Reich, welcome.
Good evening, gentlemen. Jonathan Rich from the Tarzana.
Oh, sorry.
That's okay. I've gone through life like that. I'm from the Tarzana Neighborhood Council, and my members, I think they express two things to me more clearly than any other. The first is we have a lot of confusion as to what the budget deficit really is. The last 2 weeks, we've heard numbers all from city officials, from Mr. Santana's office, from the mayor's office, from other offices that say somewhere between $216 million down to a low of $10 million. It's very hard for us to get around supporting a tax increase, which we all think we pay too much in taxes, when we don't even know what the real number is. And if the city was run, I think, like a real business, I run a business, my constituents run businesses, we can't have that kind of a widespread. It just doesn't make sense to us. It's very hard to support anything that comes out when we don't know what the real number is. The other thing they all tell me, consistent with really running a real business, is why do city employees get so much better pensions than the rest of us do? We all understand you've got fixed pensions that were promised, and people should get the pension they were promised. That was the commitment that was made to them. But why haven't they started today and said, every new employee, you get the same 401k that I get? Now, it may take 20 years to get to where we need to get. My family's been here since 1892, so well over 100 years. We're all going to be here for a long time. We don't understand, and maybe the city has a reason for it, but we don't understand why city employees get a defined benefit pension plan that no one else in private industry gets anymore. It seems to us very unfair. Thank you.
Thank you. And when we've concluded with the public comments, I am going to ask Mr. Santana to come back up. I should have asked before, and thank you for raising the point, this issue of changes in the projected budget deficit. I want to touch upon it at a little bit greater length, so thank you. I'm very sorry that I'm not able to get through this. It looks like the last name is C-U-S-T-E-O, Cousteo, or something close to that. The first name is either Pam or Paul. No? Okay. Oh, maybe it is Castro. I'm sorry. Yeah, it could be Castro. Is there a Mr. or Ms. Castro? No? Okay. Sorry, next speaker then will be Jack Humphreyville, followed by Barry Johnson.
My name is Jack Humphreyville. I'm with the Greater Wilshire Neighborhood Council. The city's finances are out of control. Over the last 7 years, the pension liability, the unfunded pension liability, has gone up by over $1 billion a year, from $4 billion to $11.5 billion. At the same time, the deferred maintenance budget has probably increased to north of $10 billion. These are both the equivalent of debt, so we're talking about debt of $20 to $30 billion. The budget seems to be out of control. Over the next 4 years, we have a budget deficit of cumulative deficit of $1.1 billion. And the primary reason for that is that personnel expense is increasing at a rate $300 million greater than revenues. And this is the continuing pattern because over the previous seven or eight years, personnel expense have increased about $1.4 billion compared to an increase in revenues of about $850 million. Salaries have gone up about 35, are scheduled to go up by 35% since the beginning of 2000 and the fiscal year 2006 to the end of the current contracts. The city has gone out there and told us we've done all sorts of reforms. We got rid of 5,000 people off the general fund, but nobody talks about how much it cost, not only to the general fund funding the ERIP, as well as the impact on the ratepayers of the city of Los Angeles. We talk about the increase of the 4% to pension contributions or health care contributions, but nobody talks about the 35% pay increase that there's been over the last, will be since through the Villaraigosa administration. We talk about the Tier 2 pension reform. Unfortunately, that is a situation where it will only save $15 million in the fifth year. The solution is a charter amendment where the city is required to live within its means, and I would dare to say that if we're on the ballot, it would probably get north of two-thirds of the vote. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Barry Johnson, followed by Dr. Molly Rhodes. Mr. Johnson, welcome.
Good evening. Barry Johnson, Studio City stakeholder. Dollar for dollar, the money spent on individual neighborhood councils and their elections is probably the best spent government money in this country. With it, you get an army of worker bees who work for free and endeavor to make LA a better place to live. Now more than ever, we have become the proactive eyes and ears of Los Angeles city government. Most of the time now, we are the ones bringing issues as well as chores to be done to the city's attention. The Neighborhood Council's portion of the city's total budget I'm referring to is a very tiny, tiny fraction of even 1% of the total budget. Yet, year after year, the city plays this game with us, holding us hostage, keeping us on edge like a soap opera cliffhanger. This is downright wrong and disrespectful of your volunteer army of workers. Do the right thing. Take us off the table. We've been on the chopping block every year for several years. Enough is enough. Just leave us alone this year and let us do our work. And I additionally would just like to say on the topic of pensions, the time has come in this city for all new hires to be on 401ks. I mean, I work for a national corporation, and that's all I have. And the gravy boat had sailed a long time ago on pensions. And it's still going to take us 50 to 60 years for everyone that's already an employee of the city to retire and finally die before we have the commitment to this money that we have to put towards it every year. So now's the time. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Dr. Molly Rhodes, followed by Ann Jobe. Welcome.
Hello, council members. You feel so far away after our afternoon meeting. My name is Dr. Molly Rhodes, and I'm a research analyst for SEIU 721, and with the Coalition of Unions, was part of the team last year that helped develop cost-saving solutions for the city, and we're looking forward to rolling up our sleeves again this year with you all. I also want to thank you for just making clear that civilian workers do very essential public safety work. You mentioned recreation and park workers. I would add to that librarians. Everyone in the city is doing work that our city needs. And I have to say, listening to the commentary on pensions, it saddens me that in our country we have no historical memory of the fact that private sector workers used to get pensions. And the reason why you don't have them now is because we let them go away. And some private sector workers do still have them. I have in-laws who worked in steel factories. They retired on pensions. And public sector workers, unlike private sector workers, do not receive or pay into Social Security. So when people blithely talk about turning things into 401ks, it's really doing a disservice to our community, because we do not want to create impoverished retirees. That's the last thing the city of Los Angeles needs. I want to get a little bit in my 13 seconds into money weeds. Just earlier today, I asked questions about the FSR, and Councilmember Kerkorian, I had given those questions to you. I don't think I have time to go through them all now, but if you could ask those, that would be great. Thank you.
Sure. All right. Thank you. Our next speaker is Ann Jobe, followed by Dr. Weissman offering public comment.
Hi. I'm Ann Jobe from the Sylvan Neighborhood Council. I'm on the board, but I'm just speaking for myself. I was very happy to see that there was a survey taken to get input as to what we, the people, think is important. And I'm just taking an example of that. The animal services, 39% of the respondents preferred to increase the funding for animal services. As far as I can see, that's the only one where it was really requested that we increase, and that was in animal services. And yet I'm looking at this that says animal services is going to be down 21% if I'm reading this correctly. So that sounds unresponsive to me. And I heard about the general manager of animal services, who was hired in June of 2010, and her salary was $170,000. And now in this year, her salary is going to be over $202,000. And in addition to that increase in that salary, if this is correct, if my information is correct, I hear also that six facilities of shelters are going to get rid of, not use, their midnight to 6 a.m. employees to care for and maintain those structures. And instead of having those two people who, at each structure who is trained in that, rather than that, there's talk of having a guard come and guard the facility. So this is something that just strikes me as a citizen as wrong-headed, and I would like for you to take that under consideration.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Ms. Job. And just for clarification, the chart that you're looking at in this presentation is not a projection of a cut for the future. This is the reality of what has already been cut. So the 21% reduction you see is the actual reduction in animal services that's happened in the number of positions from 2009 until this fiscal year. So this does not even take into account anything that may be proposed by the mayor in his coming budget. I also heard this proposal, as we all did, about nighttime hours. And when the mayor's budget is proposed, if it does include that provision, that will be something that will be closely scrutinized by this committee, I can assure you. Mr. Kratz.
And that, it's not clear to me. It may actually be being implemented even now, and I have concerns about that also. So we'll be taking that up at some point in the Personnel and Animal Welfare Committee as well. So we're at least watching that one and very concerned.
Thank you. All right. Now, apparently taking me quite seriously when I said that this was not going to be his only opportunity to comment, Dr. Weissman is back for public comment. Welcome back.
Oh, my thanks, sir. The reason I'm coming back here is we have heard the comments on the two proposals, the DWP transfer proposal and on the rescheduling of the budget above the business tax. And I believe there are arguments to be done, and therefore what I'm actually doing is not trying to maximize my video time, but to try to start an engagement with Mr. Santana, because I think many of the issues that they bring forward are real, they can be answered, and I think we can work out ways in which some adjustments to this TRAN can be done. I focus on the expense of the TRAN related to the line of credit portion of it. The other portion is a good deal when the pension plans make more than 7.75% as their smooth ROI is. But when they, as in the last several years, make less than that, this is sapping money out of their assets, and I don't think that's entirely fair to them. I think that needs to be addressed as well. Thank you so much. I hope this is the beginning of a whole series of communications.
Indeed. Thank you. And in that spirit, I also want to invite Mr. Santana to come back up for a moment, because not so that we have a back and forth going. No, but I think there was a point, there was a point raised earlier that has been raised frequently, especially over the last few weeks, about the changing estimate of what the budget deficit for fiscal 2013-14 will be. And Dr. Rhodes actually raised a few questions about that, and specifically in her comments, she noted that there was still a $216 million projected deficit in the February FSR that, in her view, did not take into account revenue growth projected at $55 million, retirement cost reduction of $44 million, encumbrances of $18 million. Those were encumbrances that were disencumbered so that they could be brought back into the general fund, and expenditure shortfall of negative $9.6 million. And then she also had a question regarding the reserve fund
which I'll go ahead and present to you. That's sort of off topic on this deficit issue, which I'd like you to address. But the other question she had was if the reserve fund policy is 5%, and we are now projecting a reserve in excess of 5%, would it make sense to have the excess amount reprogrammed back to the general fund to address some of the deficit? And I think it's in the neighborhood, she projected in the neighborhood of $800,000 for that increment above 5%. I think I already know the answer to that, which is that the 5% is a floor, and to the extent that we can go above that, it helps us with our credit rating, probably has far more value than that $800,000 just for that additional credit strength. The other issue there is the, of course, fluctuation that happens over the course of the year. That little margin may be the difference of whether we're above or below 5% over the course of the year. But that's my seat of the pants reaction to the reserve fund. But I would like you to address this issue about the fluctuating budget deficit estimates, please.
Certainly. The deficit is determined once a year, and it's determined as part of the budget process. So when the mayor submits a budget, in there it explains how that year's deficit is being addressed, but it also provides a forecast of what this budget would do to the following year deficits. To the extent that the council adopts that budget, that forecast follows whatever changes. So if the council were to make more ongoing reductions or identify more ongoing solutions, then the out year's deficits get reduced. Conversely, if the council were to spend more or eliminate revenues, then the deficits increase. So the deficits are established at the end of the budget process. And the reason we do that, and we try to do it only once a year, is because it is those projections that we rely on when we communicate with the bond rating agencies and investors as we project out. Now, obviously, as you know, Dr. Weissman indicated, and I think Jack did as well, the budget is a plan. It's not set in stone, and obviously on the first day of the fiscal year, the budget changes because certain expenditures happen that we didn't anticipate, and then revenues track on budget or don't track on budget. So we could certainly be in the business of adjusting the deficit, the out-year deficits, almost on a quarterly basis based on the information that we have. And we don't do that because, again, it's important to mark the deficit at a moment in time for both our internal planning as well as for our communication externally. What we try to do after Measure A failed is, while we didn't change the projected deficit, we did give you an indication of how things are looking. And so we started that in the FSR, where we talked about projection, how revenue is tracking this year, and if that were to continue for next year, what that could potentially look like. We provided more detail in the context of the Crossroads, City at a Crossroads report, where we mentioned the fact that we actually are seeing improvements in our pension contributions, as well as the objective of having a healthy budget stabilization fund. And then finally, in the report after the election, we provided greater detail. The revenue projections aren't determined and set in stone in the budget until right before we go to the printer. You know, last year, literally days before we went to the printer for the budget, I got a call from my colleagues at the county who said, oh, guess what? Our property value projections need to be readjusted. And then soon, several after the budget was, and they were adjusted to the negative. And so we had a scramble.
By a very significant amount.
That's correct. And so we had a scramble and identify solutions to help address that shortfall. And then, of course, the budget was released, and then it was brought to your council in the final days of your council adopting the budget. We received another call saying, oh, guess what? Our revenue projections are changing now to the positive. and that provided additional revenue for the CLA and for your council to budget in to address some of the shortfalls and the reductions that were being contemplated. So, you know, projecting revenue isn't a science. It's a, and so we try to rely on the most current information before the budget is printed, before we establish that. And so I could appreciate the frustration around the changing in the deficit projections, and that's why we try to maintain the same benchmark while at the same time disclosing to you, to the public, how things are looking. It's important to note, and because others have said to the contrary, that most of this information about our pensions looking better than what we projected, increase in ongoing revenue, as well as the budget stabilization fund, were all presented publicly to your council a month before the vote on Measure A. There was no attempt by anyone to try to hide that information. And so I think in speaking to the mayor, you know, after the day after the election, I think the mayor was simply talking about what had already been publicly disclosed prior. And we certainly wanted to solidify that with the subsequent report, which you heard in your committee today.
So just to sort of sum up, the projected deficit for 13-14 had been set at $216 million. There were a number of improvements in economic condition, improvements in revenue, policy changes, and other savings that were realized over the course of the year that helped to chip away at that projected deficit. But as we stand here now, just with a few months left of the fiscal year, what is your best estimate at what remains of the deficit still to be corrected for 2013-2014?
So as we're, you know, working with the mayor's office now, our challenge is somewhere in the neighborhood of $150 million. And this, again, assumes that some of the expenditures on the public safety side actually get taken care of. So, you know, the deficit is both reflective of most current revenue projections, but obviously also on the policy decisions that are made by first the mayor and then your council. And so based on where we understand it going without revealing what the mayor's budget is, that's sort of the problem we're working on. Our advice to both you and the mayor is that to the extent that we solve that $216 million, that two-thirds of those solutions be ongoing to help reduce the structural deficits in the future, and that only one-third be one-time. Because for every dollar that you solve with one-time money, you only have to confront that problem all over again in 14-15. And so it's a, if we're ever going to be in a place where we ultimately eliminate the structural deficit, then to the extent we can move as much one-time solutions as possible, then that would be helpful. That's what really what Measure A was about.
So when people have said, for example, that, well, they swept the encumbrances, so that should be counted as solving part of the budget, projected budget deficit, or they have a budget stabilization fund of $50 or $60 million that they've generated, and that should be counted towards deficit reduction. You could do that, but if you were to do that, you would essentially be spending one-time money to correct an ongoing structural deficit.
That's correct.
So you'll still, I mean, that is literally kicking the can down the road then. So for those who criticize sometimes the city for kicking the can down the road, if they're suggesting that we should have counted those and accounted for those one-time money items as deficit reduction, what they're essentially proposing is that we continue to kick the can down the road.
That's, I couldn't have said it better myself.
All right. All right. Anything further? Mr. Kratz.
One other question. One thing that came up that I think often is misunderstood is, why don't we switch to a 401k? Why is that financially not a positive thing for us to do.
So when your council considered the new pension tier, we actually studied a number of options. We had about a dozen different options analyzed and reviewed by independent actuaries. And one of them was, in fact, a 401k, as well as a hybrid proposal. And it was determined at that time that if a 401k were to be established, it actually would increase our deficit in the immediate term and then for a period of time. The thinking is that if every new employee has a 401k and now keeps their own revenue, or their own pension contribution, rather, and invest it privately or through a system that the city creates, then it dries up the revenue that's come in to provide the pensions that have been promised to the 30,000 employees that we currently have and the 30,000 retirees that are currently in the system. And so over the short term, it actually makes our deficit bigger, not smaller. Now, the way San Diego pursued a similar idea, the way they did it is that they basically committed to free salaries for current employees for a period of 5 years, and they said they would basically make up that shortfall by freezing salaries. And what's being challenged right now in the court is their right to do that without going through the full meet and confer process. And they did it through initiative. So the city, after reviewing that option, chose not to pursue it because of both the cost, and I think there was some serious consideration over the policy implications of maintaining a defined benefit program. So the new pension tier, both on the civilian sworn side, protects the defined benefit program that this city has. The unique aspect of the new pension tier on the civilian side is that it borrows one concept from the 401k idea, and that is currently when the pension systems do well financially through the stock market, then the pension systems benefit from that. When they don't do well, employees are entitled to receive the same pension. However, the city has to make up that difference. And so as a way of addressing that impact for new employees, the city for the first time is going to require new employees to pay half of whatever unfunded liability is created over a three-year period. So we will share in that upside and downside on any changes in the stock market, which is a concept that's obviously more reflected in a defined contribution plan, because if you invest in a 401k when the economy does well, your 401k does well. When it doesn't, you lose money. In this case, we're borrowing some of that concept while still protecting a defined benefit.
Gotcha.
And thank you for raising that question, Mr. Kretz, because I think this raises a larger issue about how to fix things. And when our former Mayor Reardon proposed this change to lock in 401k, a 401k approach for public employee retirees, there was no need, because this was being done through the initiative process to, you know, through the public process to put this on the ballot. There was no requirement that there be an economic analysis of its impacts. When we do changes like this here in City Hall, they have to be analyzed by independent economic analysis. And we learned through that process that this would actually cost more than it would save.
That's right.
And had this gone to the ballot and been voted on by the people, they never would have had the opportunity to learn those facts. So I think it's a word to the wise to keep in mind that when proposals are put on the ballot outside of the legislative process, it's kind of a buyer beware situation. And I think people need to really look closely at the economic analysis of these sorts of changes before they assume them to be cost-saving measures. So with that, Mr. Kretz, if you have nothing further, we have concluded our business and heard the comments of those who wish to speak. So until next time, I want to thank everyone for taking the time to come out and participate in this process, and we are adjourned.
City View, Channel 35.
We now join our scheduled program in progress.
New dog be put into a position a dog should never be put into right away. He needs time to decompress, learn about his environment, learn to trust his owner. He has no clue where he is, okay? He's probably been in several situations in a short period of time. And if you took the time to allow your dog to decompress, learn about you, learn his environment, go slow, and get the help you need if you're having issues, you will have a dog that will settle in and be a good dog. Okay, now there are situations, of course, where dogs are adopted inappropriately for mismatch, you know, a very energetic dog with young children, you know, we can understand that, and that happens. But the main thing is these dogs need the time. They need the time to learn about you, decompress, and settle in. Get the help you need. Read the literature you get with these dogs that you adopt, because most of the shelter staff and the owners, or the former owners, or even the rescues, know these dogs and can educate you about the dog beforehand. And take that time, learn about your dog, and allow him to decompress and get the help you need. And hopefully that will get you the lifelong pet you want to have. And remember to train, don't complain. Thank you.
Hi, it's Sally and the doctor again, and we're not looking at dogs, we are looking at cats. This is a gray tabby. She's about a year old. Her impound number is A1373048. And she's actually quite comfortable just laying in her little box here. What do we say about the gray tabby, doctor?
Well, I mean, she's young. She's scared, you know. They're not used to being kept in cages, but she's petite. She looks like she doesn't have long hair, so she doesn't probably shed as much as a long hair, but she looks like, I'm sure once she got into a loving home, she'd be fine.
The shelter does have her listed as a stray, so it may mean that she has not been handled by people a little bit, and this is an unusual circumstance just to begin with, right?
Absolutely. Every single cat that comes into a shelter, whether they were on the streets or in a loving home, are stressed out because gotcha. It's very unnatural for a cat.
Okay. She does not have a name yet, so you will be the lucky person who gets to name her. Her impound number is A1373048. She's at the North Central Shelter on Lacey Street. Come see this beautiful little gray tabby who will stay little. Yes.
Yes.
This is Gwen. She was an owner surrender at the end of January of this year. And boy, would she like to have a new owner. She said, I am so friendly. I love these scratches. Oh, doctor, do it some more. My impound number is A1370011. She's about 4 years old. What a beautiful... Oh, and she's a talker.
Oh, yeah, she's darling. Look, see, she's been... You know, people don't realize how affectionate cats are. This is a cat that would probably be loved to be petted and greet you when you come home because she's very loving. you know, very unconditional love. It's a different love than a dog love, but she's a very sweet kitty. Oh, she is.
Yes. And wagging tails on cats, is that similar to wagging tails on dogs?
Well, you know, not really. It depends if it's a light wag, but if it's a wag, watch out.
Okay. So she's got a light wag going
on.
Yeah,
she's enjoying this.
Her name is Gwen. Oh, her impound number is A137-0011. She's ready to go right now. Please come see Gwen at the North Central Shelter. And look at those beautiful green eyes.
She's beautiful.
You're a pretty cat, Gwen. This is Nina.
Nina.
They're calling her a gray tabby, but she's got a little of that calico brown in her, doesn't she?
Beautiful.
Her impound number is A137-0937. She's about a year old. She would be then full size, correct?
Oh yes, she's full size, and she's super sweet too. Look, yeah. And you know they're just they're hiding in the little boxes because, you know, like I said, it's very loud and all this activity, and they're super stressed when they come in, so it's hard to get a take on their real personality. But this cat will probably be super sweet when she's in a little home. She's just scared right now.
And she is beautiful. Her name is Nina. I kind of like the name. Her impound number is A137-0937. She's just about a year old, and she is gorgeous. We have another cat that looks a little bit like Nina. This is Lila.
You see her, like, trying to rub on things? They have scent glands in their cheeks, and so they're trying to get their scent on you or in their environment. Cats like routine. Yesterday should be the same as today, and today should be like tomorrow. That's why they get stressed out when they come in the shelters, because they're out of their element. They need to have control of their environment. She's purring. She's very happy. She's a happy girl.
So this is Lila, A137-1005. Domestic short hair. They're actually calling her a tortoiseshell, and she is gorgeous. She is beautiful and loves people. She said, oh, just take me home. Take me home with those other three cats that we just looked at. Please, I would love to have some attention.
Yes.
137-1005. We are looking at a female brown tabby and white. Her impound number is A137-3611. She's also about a year old, but much more petite than the last one we looked at. She's a beauty. Oh, she said, I talk. I have beautiful green eyes. I was a stray. I'm about a year old. You picked her right up, and she was fine.
Oh, yeah. She's super sweet. She's very petite. She's purring right now. She just needs a home, unconditional love, and a lot less work than a dog. You don't need to walk them, and cats are misunderstood. I love cats, and I think everybody should try a cat. Yes.
Got that, everybody? Try a cat. Try this one, who you can name. A137-3611. She would love you to hold her and pet her.
Aww.
We're looking at Hattie, A137-0942. The doctor said something about the pupils being dilated. Would you like to explain that?
When cats are scared, their pupils will dilate. It's that fight or flight response. You'll see they're starting to soften a little bit, but that's usually a signal the cat is very stressed, and to kind of let them calm down before you interact with them.
She is a gray tabby. She is spayed. Her impound number is A137-0942, and she does have some beautiful green eyes in there. Beautiful markings. Her name is Hattie, and Gwen underneath her is talking to us and would like to say, Hattie, come on, Hattie, please, come on, Hattie, you can get as much attention as me. Hattie is A137-0942. Come bring her out of her shell at North Central on Lacey Street. We have two male orange tabbies. They're about 2 months old. Impound numbers A137-4281 and A137-4282. Remember the buddy program we talked about with the little chihuahuas? You can get adopt one animal, a cat or a kitten in this case, and get his brother, adopt his brother for half price. They are the cutest things going.
Yeah, and you know, two is better than one, especially with kittens, because they need to interact. People think they're asocial. They're not. And you have never had so much fun in your life watching two kittens just scare each other and act crazy. It's actual therapy for you. So, yeah, two kittens, always two, better than one.
It does keep down the work and attention that you have to put into an animal when you have two. You always say, well, go find your brother. Go see what your brother's doing. Impound numbers for our two darling kittens, A13.